Yeah, so we're about a third of the way done with our year in 2024. It really is a pleasure to be meeting with you all this Sunday. And as we remind ourselves of what has happened some 2,000 years ago, you know, who Jesus is and what he has done on the cross, and you know, him coming into the city a week before he is crucified, triumphant, you know, full of praise for what he has done and who he is, and in love for all of us and for God the Father. And a week later, he leaves still triumphant, still full of love, but scorned for what he has done and who he is. And I pray, I want to pray for us this Sunday that we continue to hold dear who Jesus is. With every head bowed, let's just pray and offer this time to the Lord. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you for everything that you have done and who you are, Lord. I pray that we as a people continue to love you, continue to love the words that we find in the Bible, Lord, that we continue to make the words complete praise and complete worship to you, Lord. I pray that you be with us, that we continue to remember the goodness that you have done on the cross. I pray that we, as a body of believers, not just here in this church, but a people you have drawn close to you. You know, I pray for the churches, the other hubs that are meeting this Sunday. I pray that they glorify you and are fruitful in their meeting together under your great name, Lord. We love you and we praise you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
As it's and in this time, let us join as one body and as one church to declare the goodness of God and his grace and his faithfulness to us. So may we invite you to stand if you're able. If you're able, let's all stand, let's all rise. Let's declare the goodness of the Lord in this place. Let's declare who he is. Let's praise his name for what he has done. For he is our living hope, our strength, the one who deserves all the glory, the honor, and the praise. So, church, let's all praise his name. As one body, let's lift his name up together. Praise his name forever. Together we sing.
Praise is rising, eyes are turning to you. We turn to you. Hope is stirring, hearts are yearning for you. We long for you. When we see you, we find strength to face the day.
And in your presence,
in your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us, worthy of all.
In your kingdom,
broken lives the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna, come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Hosanna, Hosanna.
Sing of your goodness. We praise you, Lord, and we lift your name. And as we sing of his greatness and of his goodness, we say,
my Savior, Redeemer, lifted me from the miry clay. Almighty, forever, I will never be the same, because you came near from the everlasting. Only Son, you live, you died, you rose again on high, you opened the way for the world to live again. Hallelujah for all you've done. Me from the miry clay, Almighty, forever, I will never be the same, cause you came near from the everlasting to the world we live, the Father's only Son.
We declare,
you live, you died, you rose again on high, you open the way for the world to live again. Hallelujah for all you've done.
We sing that again. You came near,
cause you came near from the everlasting to the world we live, the Father's only Son. Cause you came near from the everlasting to the world we live, the Father's only Son.
Declare,
you lived, you died, you rose again on high, you opened the way for the world to live again. Hallelujah for all you've done. You lived, you died, you rose again on high, you opened the way for the world to live again. Hallelujah for all you've done. Hallelujah for all you've done. Hallelujah for all.
Father, we praise you not just for all you've done, but for who you are. And Luke 19:38 says, blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in highest. And as we continue to sing, let us declare that he is the God who is worthy of all our praise, the God who deserves all our worship, and the God that we continually say, glory, glory in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. So let us continue to come. Let us continue to give thanks. Let us continue to worship and declare, Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Lord, we praise you.
Break my heart for what breaks yours.
Hosanna, church. We lift up the name Hosanna in the highest. And indeed, Hosanna in the highest is what we declare. For the Lord is worthy of our worship, and for He is our living hope. And 1 Peter 1:3 says, blessed is the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to His great mercy has caused us to be born again to that living hope through what? Through the resurrection. And as we remember what He has done this week, may we not just only remember what He has done, may we also remember why He did that for us. It's because the Lord loves us. And it's because of that love that is anchored, we find our living hope through that resurrection. So let's sing, let's declare, let's praise His name.
Jesus Christ, my living hope.
living hope is in Jesus. We can do better than that. Declare in the heavens that He is our living hope, that the Lord is worthy. Oh God, we put our hope and trust in You. And we thank You, Lord, because we have that assurance that You are our hope. You are our hope. And because of Your love, Lord, we stand here and worship You and declare of who You are to us. Lord, You are our living hope, and we praise You. We thank You. In Jesus' name we pray. And everyone say amen and amen. Let's applaud our God one more time. For the Lord is good, and His love and mercy endures forever. Amen and amen. Church, good morning. We thank you for joining us. Please greet each other with the love of Jesus to your left and to your right. Tell them of God's love.
Hello, check. Sound check. Good morning, everyone. Kulang sa coffee. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to CCF SoCal South. Before we start our service, I just want to give a couple of reminders. So one of the things that is most important to us in CCF, obviously, is discipleship. So I just want to remind everyone that we have a couple of D groups, discipleship groups, meeting every week. So if you're still not plugged into a D group, we highly encourage that you reach out to these people. So first, the couples. If you're married, the couples meet every Friday. And this is led by Tito George and Tita Marivic. Are you here, Tito George? So they know who to reach. Tito George! So Tito George is at the back. So if you're a married couple and you're not yet plugged into a D group, I highly recommend to reach out to him after the service. If you're just curious, you want more information, they do meet every Friday in person. Also, if you're a single lady, we also have a ministry for that that meets every Monday, led by Tita Zita. Tita Zita, can you raise your hand? That's Tita Zita. Again, you can reach out to her after the service for more inquiries. Then let's go to the youth. We have a group of young professionals. This group is called B1G. And we meet every other Friday in a hybrid setup. We meet here at church, 7:30 p.m. every other Friday. If you can't make it, we can definitely put up a Zoom link. This is led by TJ Blanco. TJ, can you raise your hand? And for the ladies, you can reach out to me as well after the service. Then for a more younger group, for the students' ministry, this is called Elevate. This is headed by Tito Keith and Tito Susan. Are you here? Tita Susan's there. So if you have kids who are in high school or early college, it's a great ministry to be in, surrounded with like-minded people, with Christians, and you can talk about your faith as students. And last but not the least, the kids, we have the Next Gen Ministry. I believe they're actually in the Next Gen room right now, and that's headed by Tita Deng Blanco. So if you have kids, you're going to church, definitely there's a group for that age bracket as well. We also have two event reminders. So what day is it today? Do you know? Are you aware? It's Palm Sunday, which means next week is Easter Sunday. And if you have friends and family, if you just want other people to hear the gospel for the first time, this is a perfect opportunity for you to invite them to church. We're still going to have a regular 10 a.m. Sunday service here. So I just want to remind everyone that's Easter Sunday. We don't have the information on the screen, but we have another event. So if you can keep this in your calendars, it's the Intentional Discipleship Conference. This will be held on April 20 to 21. So that's a Saturday and a Sunday. So this Intentional Discipleship Conference, we usually call it IDC. So moving forward, if we refer to IDC as an event, it's this one. Day one is going to be a combination of all of the hubs in SoCal. So it's a joint event. It will be held in Holiday Inn at Long Beach. And this is going to be from 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. The second day of the plenary will be on a Sunday. So we will still meet here at church. So it's our usual Sunday time, but we're going to go over the contents of the second day for this session. Will there be live speakers? No, this is an initiative that was spearheaded by Main. So they already have a lot of great content that they can share to us. So we will be streaming their content in these sessions. Now, there is a registration fee for you to join. We do highly encourage everyone to join, knowing that discipleship really is one of our core in this church. So it's $30 per person. And you can send your payment via Zelle at stewards@ccfla.org. I know this is a lot of information, so if you're really curious, you can definitely reach out to any of the church leaders here, to the ushers, to Tito George for further information. Since it's a whole day event for day one, lunch will be served, so that's great. It's part of the payment that you're paying for day one. And if you have children, there's actually childcare provided for that day. So you can bring your entire family and no one gets left behind. So yeah, the payment for $30 applies to everyone, CCFers or non-CCFers alike. So we'll keep on reminding you every week, but if you have any questions, yeah, feel free to reach out to us. And that's it. Okay, and let's listen to our preacher for today's service.
When God disciplines us, one, don't take it lightly, but two, don't lose hope, because God is doing it because He is a loving, tender God. Today, we tackle a topic that people sometimes don't want to talk about because love has a side to it. That is the tough side of love. Love is tough and tender. And we have to remember that there's a side to love which says love seeks the highest good. And sometimes the highest good is not giving someone what they want, it's doing what needs to be done. In God's case, God disciplines us. So the topic of today is love through discipline. And we're gonna talk about one of my favorite Bible characters, King David, as well, as we go through it. So we have three simple points. The first one is, what is the reason? The second point is, what should the response be? And the third point is, what is the result? So when we talk about what is the reason, if we look at these verses, it says, you have not yet resisted to the point of shedding blood in your striving against sin. Notice that in the Christian life, it is hard. And part of the hard part of being a Christian is this battle against sin. The Bible never says it's going to be easy. So one of the reasons that discipline is part of our lives is because we must learn to strive against sin. And the Bible actually uses an amazing analogy. It wants us to get to the point where we can resist to the point of shedding blood. There's nothing in life worth having that is easy. Everything comes at a cost. And learning to strive against sin is part of why we go through discipline. But verse 5 tells us the tender side is it's related to who we are. It says, you have forgotten the exhortation which is addressed to you as sons. Remember, we are God's children. So discipline helps us remember. It says, my son, Do not regard lightly the discipline of the Lord, nor faint when you are reproved by him. There's two sides to our issues with discipline. One is we regard it lightly. And, you know, as an example, sometimes we struggle with sin. God allows circumstances to bring us back. And then what happens? Things are going okay, we forget. That's regarding lightly. Or you think, you know what? God's loving, it's okay. That's regarding lightly. The other extreme is we faint when we are reproved. Like, it's too much, God. I can't take it. So we lose hope. Bible's telling us when God disciplines us, one, don't take it lightly, but two, don't lose hope. Because God is doing it because he is a loving, tender God. For those whom the Lord loves, he disciplines. So what is the reason we are disciplined or that love disciplines? It's love. As a parent, I really love my children. There's a verse I'll show you later. I discipline them. So those whom the Lord loves, he disciplines, and he scourges every son whom he receives. The original Proverbs doesn't use the word scourge, but in this verse it does. And scourging is a higher form of a more painful form. And sometimes, you know, in our lives, we don't listen, and God allows the consequences to get worse and worse and worse. And I know many of us have experienced God's discipline, and it's painful. So the Christian life is not a walk in the park. And one of the reasons we are disciplined is, first, God loves us. Verse 7, it is for discipline that you endure. God deals with you as with sons. For what son is there whom his father does not discipline? So this verse tells us that discipline itself teaches endurance. And part of the goal of discipline is because we are children. It says, what son is there his father does not discipline? So discipline is a goal, right? It is for discipline that you endure. It is part of our lot. We endure because it is who we are. We are children. And look at this, verse 8. If you are without discipline, of which all have become partakers. The Bible tells us if you are God's children, discipline is part of life. You are a partaker of discipline. So sometimes you see people, they do sin, they do things and they get away with it. And you're wondering, God, why? Well, maybe they're not God's children. It says here, if you don't have discipline, then you are illegitimate children and not sons. Because it says, what son is there whom his father does not discipline? So discipline is part of our nature. It says we are partakers as Christians. Furthermore, we had earthly fathers to discipline us, and we respected them. Shall we not much rather be subject to the Father of spirits and live? So, we are disciplined. What is the reason? Because of love. We are disciplined because we are his children. It's our nature. We are disciplined because if we are subject to discipline, the result is true life. Sometimes we think, Lord, I want to be able to do what I want. I want this, I want this, I want this. But God says, I know what you need best to truly live. And so discipline is part of that. My children, if I let them do whatever they want, they won't have the best life. I have to discipline them. And that's part of discipline. The same word, we'll talk about it again, is paideo. It's used there, and here is another use of it. It's so different. All scripture is inspired by God and profitable for teaching, reproof, correction, and training, paideo, in righteousness. What does that word mean? It refers primarily to the training of discipline or discipline of children and includes instruction, discipline, correction, and warning. So God's discipline in our lives has two parts, to keep it simple, the correction part when we do wrong and the training part. The correction part, you sin, there's consequences, God allows consequences, God brings consequences. You know, sometimes we want the easy life, and God says, nope, I'm training you. I'm bringing you through tough times. For they discipline us for a short time, this is earthly fathers, as best to them. But how does God discipline us? For our good. so that we may share in his holiness. Look at that point. So what's the last broad idea? We have discipline. Love is discipline. Love disciplines because, one, God loves us. He's our Father. He wants us to truly live. And then we may share in holiness. Part of discipline teaches us to what? Resist sin. So we can share in his holiness. You know, this is not about salvation and forgiveness. This is about sanctification. We'll talk about that at the end. But God wants us to share in his holiness. He who withholds his rod hates his son. Oh, but he who loves him disciplines him diligently. So we looked at the reason. Now we're going to look at the response. And to look at the response, we're going to look at the life of David. What is a godly response to discipline? Now, when you guys think of David, King David, what do you think of? A man after God's own heart. Isn't that an amazing credential? It says here, right? After he removed him, which is Saul, who disobeyed God, he raised up David. I have found David, the son of Jesse, a man after my heart, who will do all my will. You know, that's one of the things we learn about. Discipline teaches us holiness, a man who will do all my will. So David is known as shepherd, poet, songwriter, giant killer, king, ancestor of Jesus. But one time, he was walking on the roof of his palace when the kings go to war. And he didn't go to war. He was lazy. And we've heard this message many times. Sin begets sin. So David, his eyes wandered. He was awake at a wrong time. And he saw a woman bathing. And instead of looking away, because the Bible says, you know, to look at a woman lustfully is adultery. What did David do? He desired her. And he had a relationship with her. She was married. For those of you who may not know all the details, she was married to one of David's loyal men, Uriah. And then what did David do? God didn't allow him to escape. She got pregnant. David thought, everything's okay. She got pregnant. And then he said, Uriah, come back. And he had Uriah go home. He wanted Uriah to sleep with his wife. He thought, surely it'll be hidden. But Uriah didn't. So David told the generals, put Uriah in front and then pull away. So he implicated his own generals in murdering someone who was his friend. So David, all these things on the left side, is also known as a betrayer, a liar, a deceiver, adulterer, and a murderer. Yet the Bible says David was a man after God's own heart. You know, all of us can relate with David. What happened to David? Do you think God disciplined him? You can be sure. In 2 Samuel 12, 9 to 10, look at what God sent Nathan. All of us need a Nathan, or we should be a Nathan to someone. And what did Nathan say? Nathan said, why have you despised the word of the Lord? By doing evil in his sight. Notice, everything David did, Nathan said, you're despising God's word. Then he said, you have struck down Uriah the Hittite. And if you go to the end of the verse, he says, now therefore the sword shall never depart from your house. Because you have despised me. You know, all sin is against God. Yes, David sinned against Bathsheba, against Uriah, but when he was confronted, the main issue, he was sinning against God. He despised God and despised God's word. You know, this is a condemnation on sin. That's why the Bible says, do not take lightly sin. It is a terrible thing. So what is David's response when he was corrected? David said, I have sinned against the Lord. What happened? Nathan said, the Lord has taken away your sin. You will not die because we deserve to die because of our sins. So he was forgiven. But because by this deed you have given occasion to the enemies of the Lord to blaspheme. You know, many people knew about this, I assume. The generals whispered and talked about it. You didn't see David, do you know what he did? The child that is born shall surely die. I believe the consequences David experienced is not just for his generals, it's for us. Generations later, to realize God hates sin so much, he will not allow sin to go unpunished. And this is not to bring us all to a point of despair, because later on we will see God's redemption. But we should never take sin lightly. And that's why discipline is part of our life. If you want to see what David said, when I kept silent about my sin, so this is Psalm 32, he said, my body wasted away through my groaning all day long. For those of you who have lived in sin, you know that feeling where you just feel the weight of guilt. For day and night, your hand was heavy upon me. My vitality is drained away as with the fever heat of summer. But here's the great tender side. I acknowledged my sin and my iniquity I did not hide. I said, I will confess my transgressions, and you forgave the guilt of my sin. So David experienced God's forgiveness, but what was his response? It was repentance. So first, what is the reason? God's love and all those things I shared. But then, what should our response be when we experience discipline? Repentance. Like David. No excuses. I'm sorry. So, that's David's response to correction. How about his response to training? You know, David was trained. I'll give you examples. When David was anointed king already, he did not immediately become king. He had to run away from Saul for years in the wilderness. You know, when David was a child, he was a shepherd. What did David do when he was watching sheep? He learned how to speak sheep, right? Or, you know why? I think he was so good at a slingshot. What else do you do if you're out in the wilderness with nothing to do? You practice hitting your slingshot at a little branch. That's how he hit Goliath in the head. He was trained because he had nothing else to do. But David was a shepherd, and he was trained in the wilderness with God. Imagine you're a shepherd. David says, when a lion or bear came. So there's a lion and a bear, and took the lamb, what did he do? He would chase after the lion and the bear, it says, and struck him and killed him. He's a faithful shepherd. He didn't, okay lang, lion, go have the lamb, I'll stay here. No, he went after it. And if you look at the next verse, this is when he was talking to Saul. He told Saul, I have killed a lion and a bear, and this Philistine, that was Goliath, will be like one of them. That's how David learned such confidence, because he taunted the living God. David said, the Lord who delivered me from the lion and the bear, he will deliver me from the hand of the Philistine. So what did David learn when he was being trained by God? He learned faith. He learned to trust God in the wilderness. So many of us, when we're going through, not correction, let's say you haven't sinned, you're just hard time in life. What is God teaching you? To trust him. To trust that when you have nothing but God, God is enough. It's hard. And we should help each other get through it, but that's part of life. So what is our choices and response? We can either resent God bitterly, or, and that's, you know, do not despise the Lord's discipline and resent his rebuke. So when God rebukes us, we could resent it, or we can accept God's discipline reluctantly, or we can embrace God's discipline willingly. You know, David, I bet you David never forgot the consequence of sin. You think David ever forgot? Now, he sinned again later. It was a different sin. He did a census. David never committed adultery again because God didn't let him go. That's God's love. So, as we wrap up, the last part. Oh, before I wrap that part, some of us, we have a hard time repenting because we think, either one, my sin's not so bad, or number two, my sin is so bad, God can't forgive me. The Westminster Confession says, there is no sin so small, but it deserves damnation. Remember, no sin is too small. All sin deserves death. But there is no sin so great that it can bring damnation upon those who repent. So C.S. Lewis pointed out, to be a Christian means to forgive the inexcusable, because God forgave the inexcusable in us. If God forgives us, we must forgive ourselves. Otherwise, we think we are a higher judge than God. So don't forget, no matter how far you have run from God, God is only one step behind you, waiting for you just to turn around. And as long as you are alive, today is the day. So, as we get to the last part, what is the result of this loving discipline that leads to repentance? Let us look first at a poem from Pastor Joby. You guys know he loves poems, right? God's discipline, and I'll try to read it like Pastor Joby. God's discipline is not meant to crush us. No, that won't work. But to change us to do his will. Is not to punish us, but to pursue us to perfection. It's not supposed to hurt us, but to heal us from sin. It's not his way to get even, but his way to give us the best. It's not to throw us away, but to transform us his way. It's not for us to rot, but for us to repent and be restored. It's not what leads to forsaking, but love with forgiveness. It's not to bring us pain, but to bring us peace from guilt. It's not out of his loathe for us, but because of his love for us. Pastor Joby. So, what is the result? You know, Michelangelo was asked by a student how he sculpted an angel out of marble. And he said, I saw the angel in the marble, and I chiseled until I set it free. God sees us with an eye we do not have. He loves us so great. He sees who we can be in Jesus. So God is working to bring us to that person we were designed to be. If you look at 1 John 1:9, the result. First, if we confess our sins, he is what? Faithful. He is faithful. It doesn't say we are great and righteous. Because of what Jesus did, it's righteous for him to forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. It's not just, it's not he's doing us a favor. Because of what Jesus did, the righteous thing is to forgive us when we confess our sins. Because of Jesus, it's not us. It's freedom. Another thing we experience is, train up a child in the way he should go. When he's old, he will not depart from it. Godly character. You know, God sees us as children, and he wrote this. So he's training us so that someday we will have that character. And each day we get more and more, right, of that godly character. And I think what we learn here we will use someday when we rule with him. Then it says, all discipline for the moment seems not to be joyful, but sorrowful, yet for those who have been trained by it, so discipline is not joyful. Sometimes it seems not joyful. It doesn't say it is not joyful. It seems not joyful, but sorrowful. None of us like experiencing discipline. Yet for those who have been trained by it, yields the peaceful fruit of righteousness. That's hard. It's hard to discipline. But what does it do? It yields the peaceful fruit of righteousness. You know, righteousness brings peace. We talked about this. To go to bed at night, knowing that you are right with God. That no matter what happens, if the world came to an end, you know where you're going. What is that? That's peace. To know that if no matter what happens in life, you are right with God. That's the best peace, right? And this is not just righteousness in Jesus, it's also sanctification. I believe it's both. Therefore, in Hebrews 12:12-13, strengthen the hands that are weak and the knees that are feeble. So this is the ending of that verse. So strengthen. So, you know, because discipline is good for us, it leads to all these great things. Strengthen your hands, you know, get on it. And the knees that are feeble and what? Make straight paths for your feet. Don't stray. So that the limb which is lame may not be put out of joint. That's discipline, right? You know, when you go the wrong way, the sheep sometimes, the shepherd will put the limb out of joint so the sheep will learn its lesson. But says, rather be healed. God wants to bring restoration into our lives. So part of the result of responding well to discipline is God's healing restoration. Forgiveness, we have righteousness, we have character, and God's healing in our lives. I've asked Brian, my friend and D Group family member, to share his testimony. Can we welcome Brian Tom Wong?
Around the start of the pandemic was also the start of my life as a business owner after 12 years of working as an architect for land developers. The plan was to go full-time into build and sell, which I had been partially doing already. I was very excited to finally be able to start something on my own. I was very hopeful and prayed that God would bless me in this new chapter of my life. Admittedly, I wasn't without worry or fear, but as things started to move along, I felt God's presence every step of the way. The first property we wanted to develop fell on our lap. We were able to acquire it at the price that we wanted. The construction was smooth and it sold quickly. I felt so blessed. As we moved forward and tried to grow our business further, the success didn't come quite as easy as the first ventures. Suitable properties were harder to come by, construction prices were sky high, and the market in general wasn't doing as well as we had hoped. As the challenges piled up, my cash flow slowed down as well. Even if I did my best to prepare, I slowly saw my bank account getting lower and lower, and the timelines we set were not accomplished in a way that we had hoped for. Prayer was my lifeline in those troubling times, and I tried my best to discern where God wanted to lead me. Coincidentally, my wife kept reminding me that I should practice my profession as an architect and design for others. I was hesitant at first, for in my prideful mind, I had told myself when I started a business that I only wanted to design for my own projects. To further augment our cash flow, I decided to try my hand at contracting as well, something that I was also hesitant to do before, and partnered up with a brother in Christ who I had worked with before. Surprisingly, these were the types of projects that were coming our way, so I had to humble myself and accept that this was the way that God wanted to bless me and to provide for my family. Things were generally going well, but challenges were still there, and the growing pains were quite evident. It reached a point when I was so overwhelmed with everything that was going on that I started doubting myself, I started pitying myself, I started questioning everything. I prayed and prayed, but this time, God was silent. I would wake up with a lifeless look in my eyes and just drown myself in my hopeless thoughts and worries, trying desperately to find solutions by my own strength. My wife unceasingly prayed for me and reminded me that it wasn't in God's character to bring us this far just to let us fall. God also used my son to remind me by sharing a book that explained how we should face our problems head on and not cower against adversity. Eventually, a dear friend shared a passage from Proverbs chapter 9 with me that really helped me. Fear of the Lord is the foundation of wisdom. Knowledge of the Holy One results in good judgment. That's when I started to look up once again to our Heavenly Father and seek Him for answers. I realized that I feared my low bank account more than I feared the Lord, and that wallowing in self-pity is the total opposite of trusting Him. At the same time, God wouldn't want me to live in fear or in doubt, and that the price He paid for my life was too great for me to just hide in a corner and feel defeated. Life may be unpleasant as we are being stretched, poked, pounded, and squeezed, but in the end, God can use it to build our character. Though bruised and battered, God not just helped me survive, but made me triumph over my challenges, and I gained the following nuggets of wisdom from it. Prayer, obedience, and following Christ does not guarantee a problem-free life, but I know that whatever happens, God will give us the strength and courage to see it through. Adversity is there to refine our character, to make us more Christ-like, and to build and strengthen our relationship with God. When we pray for success and blessings, God will do His part and make sure that we are well equipped to receive it. Lastly, God is always with us and God is always for us. His plans exceed anything we could ever dream for ourselves, and we can trust in Him completely. He will never leave us or forsake us. My life today is still not without challenges and problems, but I trust that with God by my side, I have nothing to fear, because there is someone bigger in control, the architect of the universe and of our lives, and everything that He allows to happen is an opportunity to grow, mature, and glorify Him. More than worldly success and a stable bank account, God taught me to fix my eyes on Him, the author and perfecter of my faith. He reminded me to seek Him first above all things and trust Him to provide for everything that I will ever need. To God be the glory.
As we close, you know, I wanted to just wrap up with King David, because we saw what the reason is. God loves us, and it's His design. It leads to true life when we're disciplined. We saw the response. It should be repentance, like David, and you know, to trust God. And then we saw the result: forgiveness, godly character. Look at David. David, despite all of that, despite having lost a child, he loved God's commands. If you study the Psalms, David trusted God. David was grateful to God to the end of his days. And David repented when he sinned each time. And hard work is hard work. So how do we change our heart? First, I think we have to understand what David understood. You have to know the despair of guilt. Then you can appreciate the wonder of forgiveness. I think for all of us, the challenge is to really understand that before God, we are sinners. We'll never have a perfect heart apart from God. I think David understood that. You know, I asked myself, what differentiated David from Saul? And what differentiated David from Solomon? You know, Saul and Solomon, they didn't end well. Solomon had all the wisdom. He was the wisest person. You know, I think the difference with Saul, Solomon, and David is this. They all sinned. They all knew God or about God. But David repented and... See, Saul said sorry when he made mistakes, but his sorry was, I'm sorry, Samuel, can you still come with me, etc., etc. When David repented, he understood that God forgave him. I think for all of us, if we think it's our repentance that saves us, we're going to have a problem. Then you're going to keep trying to repent on your own strength. Bible tells us he made him who knew no sin to be sin on our behalf so that we might become the righteousness of God in him. All those verses we talked about, the secret is that Jesus, the author of love, went before us. And all of us can have a heart after God's own heart, but it is in Jesus Christ. God says, I will make you a new creation. So, in closing, David, at the end of his days, look at this. This is one of the last Psalms of his life, the later Psalms. He didn't complain. He said, he worshiped God. David said this, therefore, let everyone who is godly pray to you in a time when you may be found. And Hebrews tells us, today, when you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. You know, today is the day to repent. Not tomorrow, not later, now. So whenever God speaks to you, what is a heart after God's own heart? We listen. So how is God speaking to you guys? What is God telling you? Hey, it's time to start that D group. Or hey, you know, I want you to tell your children you love them. Don't wait till tomorrow. Hey, I want you to forgive. Hey, I want you to come to me, to trust in me alone to save you. That's today. Let us bow our heads and pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are a great God, that your discipline, it leads to repentance. Your kindness is for us. You are for us. Lord, I pray that all of us here will have a heart after your own heart that can only be found in Jesus. So if there's anyone here who desires to come to Jesus, just pray with me. Lord, I confess I am a sinner. I need you. But thank you that because of you, I can be righteous. Thank you for dying on the cross for my sins. Please forgive me and change me. For everyone else, Lord, I pray that we will be like David, and more than David, we'll be like Christ. And we will love and experience love from you and be grateful every day of our lives. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. God bless all of you.
Good day, CCF family. Welcome to Sunday Fast Track, where you ask real-life questions and we give you biblical truths. I'm Michelle Obligacion from the Big Singles Ministry, and we're here today with our speaker, Peter Tanchi Jr., to answer some of your questions. Good day, Peter.
Hi, Michelle. Nice to be here.
Yeah, praise God for your message. Thanks for sharing God's truth to us today. So for our first question, it's clear that no one enjoys discipline. Even the Bible tells us that. Knowing this, how can we encourage and be of support to those who are struggling with correction and discipline, whether from God, their parents, authorities, or even peers?
You know, what people don't realize is when people are going through discipline, they feel alone. They feel that, you know, God has judged them, or sometimes in the church, they feel like people are talking about them. The best thing you can do is love them. To say that, hey, God loves you. I'm here. How can I listen to you? How can I help? So to be there, to show them godly love, it takes effort. It's going to take, you know, work. That's the best thing we can do. And then to pray for them. So sometimes a lot of advice doesn't help, but to just go to God and say, I pray for this person and I'm here to listen to them, changes everything.
Right. That's super helpful. Let's be there for each other, right? The second question is, it's not easy to show tough love, especially to people that we love. What could be the impact or potential consequences if the Lord is leading us to show tough love towards others, but we disobey and we choose non-confrontation instead?
So I think if we know someone's doing something wrong and we don't tell them, I think we bear some responsibility before God, because God has called us to be like Christ. And Christ called out people when he saw them doing the wrong thing. So I think we have to do it in a loving way, because love is tough and tender. And sometimes people err on one side. They're too tender. They don't want to say anything. Oh, I don't want to create conflict. I think the challenge when you see something wrong is either one, you don't want to offend people, or you don't want to go through the drama and the difficulty But love actually says, hey, it's okay to have a tough time. So for me, with my daughter, when I didn't want to take her phone away, I realized I would be doing her a disservice. So I did. And even though she came back and told me, Dad, can I have it? I was like, no, we have to go through this process. So realizing that true love is confronting will help you have the strength to do it. But again, go to God in prayer and say, God, give me the strength. And then realizing if you don't do it, you're not loving them. So.
Right. So true love is tough and tender. Yeah. For the last question, one of the people who suffered the most in the Bible was Jesus. And people usually equate suffering with sin. So was his suffering a result of wrongs that he committed or discipline and correction from God?
Well, the Bible tells us Jesus had no sin. So Jesus suffered and suffered more than any person ever because the weight of all the sin of the world, our past, present, and even our future sins, God laid on him. And that's why he suffered so much is because God hates sin so much. He had to, his judgment was put on Christ. And that's why we can have forgiveness in Jesus Christ. So his suffering was not because Jesus did anything wrong. He was perfect. But because we did something wrong and Jesus, propitiation, Jesus paid the price for our sins.
Praise God for that. Thank you, Peter.
To respond to God's training and discipline in our own lives. And may we help those who are going through tough times to see God's hand in all of those. In all of these, may we remember that He is faithful. So let's all stand, and as we sing our closing song, His name as one church. Let's sing.
Praises rising, eyes are turning to you. We turn to you. When we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away.
Sing together.
When we see you, we find strength to face it.
your presence.
And in your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna. You are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna.
In our lives, we thank you for your word. We thank you for teaching us that you love us through that discipline. And we remember, and as we step out of this halt this week, Lord, that you and your love endure. Be with us, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. How's God's people say? Amen and amen. We invite you to stay for our discussion questions, to discuss with your D group, and to have a great time of sharing God's love. We see y'all next Sunday for Easter Sunday, for Resurrection Sunday at 10 a.m. The Lord bless you.